Hey, so do you remember these movies? Yeah, everyone does. It's the Disney Renaissance. You know, that era of Disney animated films that everyone knows about. Between 1989 and 1999, Disney was making films all about, you know, blue people shaped like balloons, women's rights, literal gods being trained by Danny DeVito.
I got a fur wedgie.
And furries. You know, there's a lot of furries in these films, now that I think about it. But with every film that came out that defined this company's identity in the 1990s, you know, there were other films that came out that no one gave a shit about. Only years later did these films ever find any traction and become cult classics. Whatever that means. The Rescuers Down Under was a really impressive technical animation showcase about... I don't really know, I haven't seen it. The Nightmare Before Christmas became arguably Tim Burton's most iconic story, with characters and songs that are staples of the holidays. And then there's... this thing.
The fuck is that? Is that a dog? Oh. Apparently not.
There better not be no goofy shit in this movie. Oh! A Goofy Movie is single-handedly the best non-Renaissance Disney film that was ever released in the 1990s. What a very specific accomplishment. Released in 1995, the film just kind of flew under everyone's radar, including Disney themselves, considering it was released between The Lion King and Pocahontas Civic. No one really cared about this movie or believed it would matter in the grand scheme of Disney's animation dominance. It had a fraction of the budget of those other films, and while it did okay at the box office, enough to eventually earn a direct-to-DVD sequel 5 years later, from what I can gather, it never really garnered any notoriety on the level of A la Dick or Beauty and the Bestiality. Over time, however, it eventually grew a following, and suddenly this 90s time bomb of a film graced people's hearts and nostalgia for a period of baggy pants and Star Trek glasses. But hey, it even gets me kind of nostalgic. And I was born in 2003, so why is that? What is it about this film that clicks that nostalgic feeling and touches my heart? Well, Roxanne probably had something to do with it. To give a very basic rundown of the story, Goofy's son Max wants to stand out above the crowd and impress his fellow classmates along with his crush, Roxanne. But Goofy, fearing he's growing apart from his son, decides to go on a trip miles across the country on a whim without asking his son ahead of time because he's paranoid that his son will be put in the electric chair. Okay, Max lies to Roxanne and tells her that he'll be at the upcoming Powerline concert, and from then on out, Goofy and Max spend the movie fighting, running from Bigfoot, surviving fatal falls with no injuries, and killing innocent bystanders. Just a swell time all around. Now, yes, the Goofy Movie has moments of cartoonish hijinks, try to act surprised, but the film wouldn't really be worth talking about if that's all it was, because Goofy has depth. Really, the film isn't about impressing a girl or saving your child from dying to electric shocks, but instead these typical and not-so-typical plot points are used to set up a shockingly realistic story about a father and a son who just can't seem to connect with each other. The film feels disturbingly honest about how awkward a parent and child relationship can be sometimes. Which is because the film itself was directly inspired off of an awkward parent and child relationship between former Disney executive Jeffrey Katzenberg and his daughter. Okay, picture this. A multi-billionaire businessman wanted to connect with his daughter, so he went on a road trip to find some common ground with her. In the end, they both decided to acknowledge their faults and to learn to come to an understanding and grow a stronger bond because of it. Take notes, Elon. And part of the reason this relationship feels so honest is because of the really wonderful voice work from our two leads. Jason Marsden captures the angsty attitude of Max flawlessly, and while his singing voice is
one more goof of the week like before
serviceable, his performance really sells how closed off Max is with his dad, and how vulnerable as a character he can be. And Bill Farmer, the longtime voice of Goofy, could have so easily fallen into the trap of committing way too hard to the character's silliness and yucking charm. And in fact, that was a worry that Katzenberg himself had. He actually pushed back against Farmer in the role because he was convinced that a more serious father take would work for Goofy. This is the same man who pushed for part of your world to be removed from The Little Mermaid, so yeah, not exactly the sharpest tool in the shed, if you catch my drift. Thankfully, Farmer delivered a real sweetness and sincerity to the role, it sold Goofy as just a really innocent and kind father. I think this whole back and forth with the creative differences between Katzenberg and the crew, it kind of demonstrates a general lack of confidence in the project from all sides. The fact that it was basically marketed as a Goof Troop movie, even being made by the same animation studio as the show, sort of dampened the expectations for the project in general.
Yes, it does feel weird to talk about the unending weight of expectations in a Goofy movie.
From the beginning, it's made abundantly clear that Goofy cherishes his son and expects a lot of great things from him, while Max, yeah, he doesn't really expect much of anything from Goofert Goof, but it's made clear that neither of these expectations can be fully satisfied by the end of their journeys. Goofy obviously wants his son to have a nice successful life with good friends, but mostly under the lens of still being a goof. From what we can glean from Goofy's life, he comes from a family that all follow a similar mindset and all treat their tradition with respect.
It's been handed down from goof to goof to goof, and now it's yours, son.
He really values the way he was raised, so he wants to raise Max in a similar way. But unfortunately for Goofy, Max comes from the worst generation, and unlike Goofington, who was raised to enjoy a simpler life with simpler ambitions and simpler joys, Max was nurtured by his peers and the culture around him to enjoy bigger and more exciting experiences. Roller coasters, monster trucks, Michael Jackson dressed in a piss-colored spacesuit. Women. I swear, Goofy is asexual and Max was just adopted. Max clearly doesn't want to abide by the lifestyle Goofy follows and wants to explore his own passions and find his own friends. But everyone around Goofy keeps telling him that this isn't how you're supposed to raise your child, that you need to be more controlling over them or they'll end up in the electric chair. Yet despite all of the doubts, Goofy still believes in Max as a person, and he defends him on more than one occasion. It's not that he doesn't love his son or that he doesn't believe he'll do the right thing, he just doesn't really understand him as a person. And the same applies to Max's view on Goofulous. Max loves his dad, and that's made abundantly clear at several points in the movie. But he's a shitty teenager, and when you yourself can't necessarily get a grasp on your own emotions around this age, then how could you ever be expected to grasp what your dad feels about you, what he does for you despite not really seeing eye to eye with you? It's difficult for both sides to really understand each other considering their clearly different perspectives on life, so all that's left really is to make assumptions about each other that can easily be manipulated by the people around them. Max is peer pressured, whether he realizes it or not, to believe that piss yellow is the latest fashion, and more importantly, that being cool is the best thing in the world, because that's how he's supposed to fit in, of course. He has friends, PJ and Bobby, who are traditionally uncool and unpopular. Despite the fact that Bobby is the chillest motherfucker in the world, I will fight this movie on that.
Look, it's the Leaning Tower of Cheesa. Huh.
Oh, by the way, Bobby is the best character in the movie.
Give me that attitude, you guys. I'm doing it all for you.
We're busted.
We're busted. But Max has been so harshly conditioned to think that he doesn't necessarily need friends or people in his life that'll accept who he actually is. He needs validation. He needs to stand out to be special. And that's literally what the lyrics of the song are about. On the flip side, Goofy's more open and kind-hearted nature can open him up to assuming the best in people, even when they really don't deserve it. And because he wants to connect with his son and is very emotionally open to suggestions, he allows Pete to be a twat and pressure him into putting Max under his thumb, like he does with PJ. He desperately wants to spend time with his son, so to him, doing this is fine, even though Max makes it very clear that he hates doing all of this. Neither of these two are necessarily wrong, they're just misguided. Goofy doesn't understand what Max truly wants, but Max doesn't understand that either, necessarily. They want to be on the same page, but their brains just don't operate the same way. Actually, it's hard to tell if Goofy Gasbear's brain even functions at all. This divide in their approaches to life often leads them to clashing, bickering, testing the limits of their mortality, but oftentimes it leads them to... You can fill a conflict with screaming and fighting for hours on end, but in my opinion, the best kind of conflict is the one we don't see. Like welcomely divorced parents. So many scenes in this movie use silence as a means to convey the awkward and uncomfortable relationship between Goofy and Max. There is no loud movement, there is no music, there's very minimal dialogue, and it mostly just consists of two characters existing. The first time this happens is when Max rightfully blows up at Goofy for taking him somewhere he'd never wanted to be a part of. Goofy was positive early on that going on this trip the way that he and his dad did was going to be the thing that connects him with his son. But because he fails to realize how he's making Max uncomfortable, Max rightfully calls him out on it.
This is the stupidest vacation! You drive me from home, you jam me in this dumb car, then drive a million miles away to see some stupid rat show!
Max grows more distant from his dad in the following scene, and eventually the two are forced into another silent moment when they get stuck in a car because of Bigfoot. It was a different time. But this time, the two are hostile. They're realizing that they want to find a connection with each other, they just don't know how. This is the turning point for these two, as they both realize what they're doing just isn't working. Max can't just ignore his dad because deep down, he cares about him. And Goofy can't just force Max to go wherever he wants him to. Once they both come to that realization, they spend the next few scenes actually forming a bond with each other, finally. Also, I really like this moment where Max noticed that Goofy wasn't enjoying everything he wanted to do, so he takes him someplace that he'd actually be excited for. I wonder if that'll become relevant later. And the final moment of silence comes after Goofy finds out that Max has been lying to him this whole time and taking him to Los Angeles instead of Destiny Islands. And after giving him a chance to redeem himself in one of the best scenes in any of these movies, I'm being dead serious, where Max has to decide on a whim where to go, and he still lies after everything they've been through, Goofy just breaks. In a very poetic fashion, Goofy gets angry at Max and completely shuts him off without so much as a glance in his direction. Just like how Max blew up at Goofenshmirtz for doing something he thought was okay at the time.
It's like poetry, sort of, they rhyme.
The quiet moments aren't just there to provide a break from the wacky antics on screen. They may just be the best, most shockingly truthful displays of how uncomfortable the two's relationship is. They clearly love each other, but they just don't know how to connect in a meaningful way. And this is what the movie truly wants to talk about. From the opening scene, this movie was never about Max's relationship with Roxanne or Max's relationship with
Bobby.
But the film is about Max's relationship with his father. Okay, like not in the weird way. Throughout this entire analysis, I've mentioned that Goofy and Max are just trying to understand each other despite their differences. I could talk about the film's music working in tandem with this message, but Sideways already has an excellent video talking about that very thing. He's a very good content creator. While there are Disney films that address a father and son dynamic, those often use it under a dramatic or fictional lens. The Lion King talks about this, but uses it as a piece of Simba's coming-of-age story. And Hunchback of Notre Dame uses a very clear-cut story about a father abusing his innocent son to lead into a dramatic message about faith and appearances. It works for that story, but it's just very simple. The Goofy movie, despite having a main character that looks like this, treats this relationship as human and as grounded as possible. And there's no one easy way to answer this conflict. It would have been so easy to paint one side as completely justified, the humble, innocent adult or the misunderstood youth. But both sides have to learn to make a compromise and find some kind of middle ground. Max doesn't get what he wants by lying to his dad, and Goofy doesn't get what he wants by forcing Max to do things his way. In the turning point scene in the middle of the film, Goofy and Max find something simple to bond over.
Hi, Dad Soup.
Huh?
Oh, don't tell me you don't remember Hi, Dad Soup.
They take joy in something small, and they use it to finally talk to each other and connect a little bit. They're finding a middle ground wherever they can.
You used to spell things out using letters like, hi dad,
or I pledge allegiance,
or I love you.
There's a reason that I wanted to talk so in depth about this movie of all Disney movies, because of something I've neglected to mention up until now. I am at the age of my life currently where I remember being like Max, but I sympathize with Goofy. When I was a teenager, I didn't get my own emotions. I had no idea who I really was, and me and my dad, while we still loved each other, I could tell that we weren't on the same page or talked nearly as much as we did when I was a kid. We just grew different interests in life that didn't connect. He was someone who valued our Southern family past and values a lot. I was someone who wanted to go into the world and find my own way in life. But at the same time, looking at all those years now fills me with a sense of regret for not really being there for my dad that much. He loved and supported me no matter what I wanted to do. But so many times, there would be almost dead silent car trips or trips to restaurants where we hardly talked because I just didn't know what to say to him. It wasn't my fault, it wasn't his fault, we were just going to different places emotionally. But I look back, and I have to wonder how my dad really felt when I started growing away from him. I feel troubled thinking about that. And watching this film reminds me of why it troubled me so much. Max doesn't hate his dad, as we've already established, and there are several moments in the film that show that. As I mentioned before, the montage had a cute moment where he wanted to make his dad happy by going somewhere he wanted to, and their duet near the end of the film, Nobody Else But You, well, it's kind of just them spilling out their raw emotions towards each other.
Whatever mess I land in, who is always understanding, nobody else but you.
Let's resume back at the car scene. Goofy hesitates to say, I love you, because while it's what he feels, he knows their relationship is so off that it wouldn't really feel right to say it right now. And when Max spells out something as alphabet soup, he doesn't say I love you either for the same reason. He says, hi dad. Something that tells Goofy Max still cares about him, but he just can't say it yet. So, can you seriously tell me any other Disney parent and child relationship, especially around this time, that had as much subtlety and nuance as this one scene? Yeah, you can. It doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. This is the best one. This conversation got to Max enough to convince him that his dad was more important than lying about something that'll never happen. So he takes responsibility and writes a note to Roxanne and apologizes for lying. Max, in a very bold and interesting move for a Disney protagonist, changes the map, a family heirloom, to go to LA and doesn't tell Goofy about it. And you can see how hard of a decision this is for him. He knows that this is wrong, but he's young and stupid, so he does it anyway. And he lives to regret it later on, when he's entrusted with that same map by his unsuspecting dad in the very next scene. And later, when Goofy finds out about the map, he gives Max another chance, and he still lies to Goofy. Do you think if he didn't say anything, they would have just crashed and the movie would have ended right there? Now let's bring up Pete and PJ's involvement with the film, because they're used to show everything Goofy should never be. Pete, much like Goofy, expects the world from his son, but unlike Goofy, he keeps PJ under his thumb at all times, and PJ is terrified of his dad at all times because of it. This strategy is effective if you want to train a soldier or an obedient slave, but as you would imagine, you're not supposed to treat your child like that. Goofy just wanted to have his son's love, but he doesn't get that by forcing it out of him like Pete does. He gets it by earning it himself. One of the best scenes in the entire movie is the hot tub scene, where Pete finds out that Max changed the map and goes to tell Goofy about it. Okay, side note, there's a lot more Goofy feet in this movie than you'd expect, and I don't know how I feel about that. When Pete tells Goofy the truth, Goofy doesn't believe him because he trusts Max as a person and he believes that his parenting style works, leading to this exchange.
Maybe Max isn't all the things that you think a son should be, but he loves me.
Hey, my son respects me.
Yeah.
Come on, man, that's raw as fuck! This whole thing comes to a head in the climax. Max and Goofenheimer have a back and forth where they both vent their frustrations towards each other, and in the end, they say this.
I've got my own life now! I know that! I just wanted to be part of it!
This leads to them making up, forming a compromise, and Max saving his dad from falling off a waterfall with the perfect cast. Oh wait, shit, I didn't even mention that. The perfect cast was a plot device set up earlier in the film, Goofy's signature fishing technique, and Goofy takes great pride in perfecting it, while Max initially doesn't seem to care. But during the climax, we find out that Max was actually paying attention to something his dad cared about and used it to help him. This whole time, Max did care about his dad, enough so that he'd listened about some random fishing move he thought he'd never use. And in the Powerline concert, shortly after this scene, when Goofy fumbles his way on stage, instead of trying to appear cool, Max tells his dad to do something that he knows, something that he finds cool.
Hey, Dad, do the perfect cast!
And the crowd loves it. So much so that after the scene, Goofy would later become a pop idol sensation and make this. Yes, this is a real thing that happened, and it's fucking hysterical. Max is no longer shunning his dad or ignoring him, but instead encouraging him to be himself. And when he gets on stage, he also acts like himself, and the crowd loves it. Yes, kids, if you want to be cool, just go on stage and disrupt a concert. It's genius. Goofy said so. In this moment, the two are embracing each other's interests. Goofy is embracing Powerline and having a lot of fun, and Max is embracing Goofy's own way of having fun. They see eye to eye, like the lyrics of the damn song. In the final scene, Max apologizes to Roxanne for lying and learns to take responsibility for his mistakes. But in this scene, we also learn that Roxanne liked Max in the first place because of his laugh. He stood out to her because he was like his dad. More importantly, he was being himself, whether he realized it or not. Throughout the movie, one of Max's biggest fears is being just like his dad. It's literally a nightmare for him. Although some might consider this a turn-on. Max is constantly ashamed of acting like his dad because, yes, while he does love him, he doesn't really appreciate him, if that makes sense. He doesn't want to be like him. So when Roxanne saw Max, she didn't fall for him because he was cool. She fell for him because he was a goof. A maximum goof, if you will. The movie ends with Max embracing his dad and properly introducing him to his new girlfriend. And Goofy doing this.
Enchanté, mademoiselle.
And later on, in the canonical Goof Troop timeline, Roxanne would end up doing this.
I love your dad. Thank you, Mr. Goofy. And I'd just like to say, I for one am glad you're our waiter.
So, contrary to what you may think, the movie basically ends with Goofy cucking his own son as revenge for destroying his car. And because of that submersive and dramatic twist, this movie gets a 10 out of 10 on principle alone.
With a badass seal of approval.
It's up there with the flashing for the best dramatic ending of all time. Well done, Kevin Ligma. Every other animated Disney film from around this time feels timeless in some way. Their worlds are fantastical or based in classical stories or mythologies that flow in any period, really. A Goofy movie, however, feels like a 90s movie because it utterly drowns itself in that 90s suburban culture. It has landlines, cassette tapes, film reels, car lighters, baggy clothes, skateboards, awful shades. You get the idea. Yet despite filling itself with that 90s vibe, the story still connects with people to this day. Even me. And I never survived through this shit. I think that's the wonderful thing about this movie. Much like how Max initially never believed in Goof Washington and saw him just as a joke, general audiences, and Disney themselves really, never believed in this movie. They thought it would be a very simple cartoonish fare that would be forgotten about. But the movie found an audience after it came out on home video. It earned a sequel, it still sells merchandise to this day, and Max even dresses up as Powerline in Disney parks to sing Powerline songs.
The Goof was severely underestimated.
I am here as a 20-year-old Gen Zer to tell you that if you never gave this film a chance, or you looked at it and you didn't really think much about it,
and what is wrong with you?
It's honestly so much better and more thought out than anyone could have imagined it being. You know, it feels ironic in a way. Disney seems to be pushing this film towards their cultural zeitgeist
because of their endless urge to milk their properties for all they're worth.
But back then, the film had so many production issues and a general lack of interest that the team wasn't even sure the film was going to come out, much less succeed. And, well, here we are. At least I can take comfort in the fact that Disney will never, ever screw this film up with a live-action remake. Please, do not do that.